On this episode of Nature in Your Face, we will be following several different salamander species on a journey from their underground burrows all the way to their breeding grounds and what we call the Salamander March.
Nature in Your Face!
Winter is coming to a close, and the first warm spring rains are only a few short weeks away. For the many species of amphibians that inhabit the forest, these rains act as an alarm clock and awakens the salamanders from their long period of inactivity, indicating to them that it's time to emerge from their burrows to search for a mate. Each year, the salamanders return to breed in the same vernal pools from where they hatched. Their journey is not without risk. Some will fall prey to skunks, raccoons, opossums, or snakes. The instinct to breed, however, is much stronger than any fear from predators, and they are relentless on their march to the breeding pools.
What's up, nature freaks? What's going on? That's Jeremy, I'm Dave, and we're standing in an area of water not much larger than a pond. Yet this water is critically important to the amphibians that inhabit this forest. It's called a vernal pool. Now, vernal pools are created by melting snow and rainwater, and they create the perfect temporary breeding area for frogs, toads, newts, and salamanders.
That's right. Another important thing about this water, it is fish-free, zero fishies. So they cannot eat the eggs and the larvae, so there's less predators here. Now, the mommy salamanders, they know this. That's why they come here every year, lay the eggs, so they can increase the survival of their babies. They are not here yet, however. Males, females, they're still in the forest, and they're under the logs sleeping. We're going to head into the forest, and we're going to track their journey all the way down to the vernal pool in what we call the Salamander March.
That's right. And we have to move quickly because Mother Nature is going to eventually pull the plug on this bathtub, and all this water is going to disappear as quickly as it formed.
Well, let's head on out. Let's do it.
All right, so we made our way into the forest, we flipped some logs, we moved some earth, booyah, we got the salamanders.
Two of the most common species. We have the spotted salamander
with the yellow spots.
Makes sense. And then I have this little black one. This is called the blue spotted salamander. It has these beautiful blue flecks along the body and the side of the tail.
Yeah, they're gorgeous. Now that we've had some warmer days, the salamanders are starting their march, they're getting active, they're moving down to the vernal pools.
And our next step is to hopefully getting them into the pools, possibly breeding and laying eggs.
Yeah, that's going to be exciting. I mean, watching them finally end their journey, get to where they need to be. Now, we don't want to hold them much longer. They are amphibians. They have sensitive skin. We don't want them to dry out. They also produce a mild toxicity, which is used to deter predators. Did I just see you lick the salamander?
Yeah, I wanted to see if it tasted like a gummy worm.
Well, how was it?
Nasty.
Yeah, no kidding. Kids, do not lick the salamanders, all right? Now, normally, it's not going to affect you. It's just probably going to taste gross, as Dave showed you. I think we need to get out of here before Dave tries another salamander.
Yellow and blue spotted salamanders are in the genus Ambystoma and are often referred to as mole salamanders due to their subterranean lifestyle. Their heads are rounded and both are attractively patterned with colorful markings. The blue spot has blue flecks on a black background, and the yellow-spotted salamander has a gray to black background color and a double row of irregular yellow spots running along the body. Both have 12 costal grooves on the side of the body, increasing surface area of the skin and providing channels that allow water to move up to the dorsum. Male salamanders emerge from under the logs first to begin their journey to the vernal pools under the cover of darkness or in the daytime during and after a heavy rain. Their powerful limbs push them through dirt and leaf litter as they go under, over, and through anything in their path, driven by the instinct to breed. At last, the exhausted amphibians make it to the water and disappear beneath the aquatic vegetation, only to have to wait for the arrival of the females. Salamanders are not the only amphibians to make their way to the vernal pool. Long before their arrival, many different frog species, including spring peepers, have already begun to breed and lay eggs in the water.
So during the day, the vernal pool is relatively quiet.
But at night, Mother Nature cranks up the volume.
Alright, so we are here where the action is, and I have two female spotted salamanders in my hand, and then I have a smaller male. Now, the easiest way to tell which one is the female and the male during the breeding season, the males get a swollen area at the base of the tail, the cloaca. So all you have to do, flip them over, check the tail, easy breezy, lemon squeezy. Now, I don't want to hold these girls and boys too long. I'm going to put them in the water, let them go about their business, but this is why we're here, and we're super excited. There's salamanders everywhere. All right, so let's let them go. Check them out. Let's watch them swim away. La-da-da. Ladies. All right. Go get them, girls. Awesome.
All right, I found another really cool species of salamander tonight. This is called an eastern newt. And you know, they're unique in that they go through a three-part life cycle. They start out in the water, then they return to land, and then believe it or not, they go back to the water as aquatic adults. Kind of like a college student. They go off to school, graduate, can't find a job, gotta return home to mommy. I'm gonna put this little guy back, just another salamander as a part of the Salamander March. See you later, buddy.
Salamander?
Yep. Oh man, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all different types of salamander eggs. Look at, I can tell these are, can you get this?
Yeah, I'm getting in there.
Now these are only a few days old, judging from the size and the fact that there's no algae inside these eggs. Oh man, it feels like I just sneezed in my hands.
It looks like it, yeah, it's disgusting. Yeah.
This blubbery stuff is like a gel, it's a protective jelly. And it's like a little airbag. It's a cushion for the eggs. Look at that, blah, blah, blah. So that's not going to hurt the eggs, but I'm going to put them back down so that we don't disturb them anymore. But just be super careful where you walk because there are eggs everywhere.
Wow, that's really cool. Good find, Dave.
Yeah, and you know what? What's interesting is it's not just spotted salamanders. There's also blue-spotted salamander eggs, and there might even be some frog eggs over here, spring peeper. So this is a big find.
I think you found the nursery.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's right. The little amphibian nursery here. All right.
Awesome. Let's keep looking.
Okay. Just be careful where you back up and step because I'm seeing them everywhere.
Both of these salamander species lay hundreds of jelly-coated eggs, depositing them individually or in small masses, attaching them to leaf litter or twigs under the water. Upon closer look, the yellow-spotted salamander eggs reveal small flecks of algae growing within the developing embryos and not just on the surface. The algae feeds on cellular waste and in return provides the cells with oxygen needed during photosynthesis. This is one of the most incredible symbiotic relationships that occurs in nature, in one of the few vertebrates on the planet that are known to have an organism living inside of them that is visible to the naked eye.
All right, everybody, check this out. We're going to show you really quick. Found a baby salamander in the larva stage here. Got the gills still. Got to put him back. Look how tiny he is compared to my finger. Soon he's going to leave the water and become an adult. But right now he's got to survive the waterways.
It was time for the salamanders to return to their burrows, where they will remain until the beginning of next spring. A new generation of babies will soon leave the water, only to return in a few years to lead their very own Salamander March.
So we've reached the end of the Salamander March. The eggs have been laid, and the frogs are here to do their job. What do you think, Dave?
That's right, Jeremy. And you know what? We're a little bit sad because we're not going to see them for another year. The salamanders are returning to the forest, and they'll be gone until next spring.
That's right. So I hope you enjoyed the show. Make sure to subscribe and share our channel for more
Nature in Your Face.